I was walking our old family dog around my neighborhood, a mix of urban and woodsy area. I kept feeling the hairs on my neck stand up and felt like something was looking at me or following me. It's a well-lit area and pockets of darkness. When I took a turn down a hill, it was kind of dark and I still felt the feeling of being watched. I decided to turn around to see if I was being watched. I saw a big black shepherd that almost looked like a shadow. I turned to pick up my dog, and when I looked back, it was gone. Didn't hear it run away on the concrete. Didn't see it run away, it was just gone. I still think about that sometimes. I always wondered what was up with that and played it off as a loose black German shepherd that got loose somewhere. But the way it made me feel and how it was able to just appear and not be there was very odd. I saw a huge black bird with a red spot above its tail. I had just entered the woods behind my house and I was looking at the ground when I heard something in front of me. About 30 feet away, a huge black bird took off. It stood up and spread its wings, which were at least 12 feet wide, which revealed a red spot above its tail. It flew away not much higher than the tops of the trees. I looked on the internet at all kinds of different birds, but nothing came close to it. This was in northwest Missouri. It looked kind of like an eagle, but huge. I used to work landscaping. I was watering some trees in kind of a remote area with only a freeway nearby. I turn around and this huge black dog was staring at me. Like this thing was the size of a wolf. I also noticed I couldn't really see its face. Like it was shrouded in black mist. It looks at me for what feels like a minute, then turns around and disappears into the forest. I ran over to see where it was going and it wasn't there. I couldn't see any tracks or paw prints and I didn't hear any leaves rustling. Middle of the day too. I remember I didn't feel scared. I felt more comfortable with the creature standing there than I felt alone. Definitely a weird day. I'm normally pretty logical about seeing weird things. I work nights and go long periods of time without sleeping, so my mind playing tricks isn't super unusual. But this happened in broad daylight with other people around and it has left me completely confused as to what happened. I was repairing a condenser in a very standard looking suburban neighborhood. Directly across the street was a mother playing in her driveway with her toddler, pushing him around in one of those plastic cars. I was walking back to my work van around the side of the house when I hear a shriek. Like a noise that you hear and know something is being hurt. I took a very quick few steps to clear the corner of the house and see what was happening. Mother across the street didn't seem to notice or hear or care. That's when I heard it again, but being in front of the house I could pinpoint it a little better. My head snapped to the house directly to the right of the one the mother was out front of. And I saw a small child staring directly at me with its mouth wide open and eyes that seemed to be completely black all the way around its eye socket. I looked at the mother, sure she had to notice or at least hear the commotion. She didn't. The thing waved. Not like in a come here motion. But more so acknowledging its awareness of me. I walked slowly back to the condenser and hid for maybe 5 minutes. When I came back around, it was gone and the mother was carrying on like nothing had happened. I had no explanation for what happened and still don't. When I went home and began to tell my girlfriend what had happened, she told me about black-eyed children. I don't know what I saw that day, but there was something so deeply upsetting about the entire situation. I'm happy calling it a cryptid if it means I'll never see them again. I've shared these stories before, but I'm going to omit the story of what my buddy and I call a Sasquatch under the assumption it was an insanely huge turtle. Even though I personally have never seen a turtle with a shell 6 feet across covered in barnacles, especially not in water that was 10 feet deep, and focus on all red eyes. For the sake of explaining it from the only time I've ever seen it mentioned in writing beyond myself, all red eyes is a ghost of a person, either black or Native American, that died in their task of helping slaves and escapees reach a safe haven. Their duties possibly included misleading, harassing, and if necessary, killing any pursuers, given the aggressive nature of the spirit. Their most striking, and only, feature, is the pair of piercing, glowing, scarlet orbs evenly spaced that float roughly between 6 to 7 feet in the air that will occasionally blink out and reappear somewhere else, usually 10 feet or so away, as if they're stalking you. Now onto the story. All parts of this story take place at a friend's house that was already known as weird. The first half is secondhand, and occurs roughly 15 years ago, well before we could drive ourselves, at that friend's birthday party. There's a lot of us, and I no longer remember the total number, but it was at least 8, quite possibly above 10. 3 or 4 of them decide they don't want to hang out in the hot basement, and opt to go jump the fence that separates the house property from the rest of his property and run down the old riverbed. They leave and maybe 5 to 10 minutes later, I'm hot too and grab a soda and head up to the landing, which has a view of both stairways in the house, and also, the part of the property my buddies have gone off to. Not long after, those who went off to romp in the night come back screaming and pile over the fence and his otherwise quiet dogs begin going insane. I pop the door open for them because that's easier than dealing with an electronic lock, and they stop out of breath on the front porch. A couple of buddies come up the stairs having heard the ruckus and we're treated to the tale of how they were about when all of a sudden one of the bamboo bunches out there began to clatter and shake violently, shoots snapping and breaking and some being hurled at them. We call BS and tell them to back off, get them some sodas and leave it be. Eventually, they work up the nerve to go again. But this time 2 new people decide to go with them. One of the people who was on the first run sits out, and they're bringing one of the dogs. Though it takes a bit longer, they prop the gates open for the dog to squeeze through, and off they go into the woods. My buddy who swore they were attacked by something sits out on the front porch, as do I and another friend. 4 of them were out in the woods, and there was at least one person downstairs in the basement uninterested. We're talking trash about them while the only person who was out there defends the lot of them. Not too long after, 10 minutes tops, we hear a loud scream, the dog sets off, setting off the other dogs, and here they come piling over the fence, the dog worming through the gates like a pro. The story's a bit different this time. They couldn't shake the feeling of being watched, once they got beyond able to see the lights of the house. Eventually, something made the dog growl, and they turned and saw what looked to be a pair of eyes, over 6 feet off the ground and burning scarlet, glaring at them. And then they blinked and were gone, only to show up a few long strides to the right. Then again, and again. And with a creeping dread, they realized that whatever it was slowly, gently, positioning itself between them and the house. This is what made them scream and bolt back to perceived safety, and quite safely this time. About 16 years ago I lived in the rural areas of Kansas, town was about 6 miles from my house and one night while I was waiting for sleep I stared out of my window and look out into the darkness. Normally I would see owls, opossums, raccoons, coyote, all just minding their business and I could always hear them. Loud and clear. One night as I am trying to get to bed I watch and listen for the wildlife and on this night there was none to be heard or seen. Being a kid I didn't notice and thought nothing of it. As the time passed I would eventually see a huge black figure moving on 4 legs and I could swear I had seen a brown bear. This thing was massive. We lived in Midwest Kansas, we have no bears. Never saw it again. I don't know what I saw but it was about the size of a large house cat. All black, pretty furry. It had a very long tail, very fluffy. Its face was flat and it had no ears that I could see. Its eyes were huge and forward facing. It walked on all fours, its front legs were big and thick and walked similar to that of a gorilla. Its back legs were much smaller in comparison, it had a very smooth gait. It stared at me the whole time we walked, I was on the sidewalk and it was slinking through people's front yards and under their porches. At one point it got too close and that's where I got a good look at it. Before I thought it was a weird cat, after I saw it up close I got very spooked and crossed the street. It kept up with me but this time walking closer to the sidewalk just staring at me the whole time. Then a car drove by and when I went to look again, it was gone. I never saw it again, no idea what even to look up either. One night about 3.5 years ago I was driving to my mom's from dad's and my girlfriend was following me in her car. Well, I looked down for 1 second and when I looked back up there's a massive coyote in front of my car. It was all mangy with big teeth and was super tall. Well, I proceeded to hit it going like 50 miles per hour. I even felt my car kinda bump as I hit it. Anyway, my girl saw me slam on my brakes, so she called me and asked what happened. Once I told her, she sounded very freaked out because she didn't see anything nor did anything come out from under my car. We were pretty freaked out, so we just finished the drive to my mom's. Once there, we looked at my car and it was ruined, like it looked like I hit another car or something. So I told my mom and we all went back to the scene and there was no coyote body or pieces of my car. It really messed me up for a long time. Well, flash forward to a couple months ago, me and my, now fiancé, learned of skinwalkers, and as we were discussing that's what I might have hit all those years ago, we heard an ear-piercing woman scream right by our front door. I mean, it sounded like she had to have her mouth against the door, but when we went out to check, there was absolutely no one. We vowed that day to never talk about it again. Not my story, but my friend was at a camp with me and we were in the same cabin. We all stayed up until we got tired and went to sleep. My friend, let's call him Chandler, and I stole some instant coffee packets from the kitchen and we had them in water at night. Chandler didn't have a good caffeine tolerance like me, so he stayed up a bit after all of us went to sleep. I asked him what he was going to do and he said he brought a novel and he was going to read it until he fell asleep. So it's about 1 a.m. and we are all peacefully sleeping and then we hear the biggest scream. Chandler was crying and shaking in his sleeping bag and everyone in our cabin came over to see what was wrong and to help him out. He's screaming really loud, and if that didn't wake up other cabins and the teachers, then his loud crying after did. Soon all the teachers were inside our cabin and I had to stay on my bunk bed to not be squashed. Chandler told us that he saw a ghost wandering around our cabin. He said he also heard the wind breeze while the ghost was moving. Another guy in my cabin backed him up, saying he also heard that. Chandler was sent home and everyone continued the camp, however, it felt really weird. I talked to him a lot when we all got home and he told me more details. I find it really weird because Chandler is the most honest guy I know and he seemed really traumatized. I was considering if it was the effect of the coffee, but he had it the night before as well and didn't see any hallucinations, plus he was a regular drinker and he loved the taste even though it made him stay up. This story shakes me to this day. So one night when there was a blood moon, I decided to try and get some decent pictures and went to a secluded spot just outside of town. Pulling into the area, I noticed a youngish tree, 3 to 5 inches in diameter, had fallen by a nearby creek right by where you could park your car to shore fish in the creek. Started setting up the scope and camera and I start to hear a lot of rustling in the brush, and since coyotes are common enough, I had my handgun on my hip so I didn't pay it much mind. But the rustling soon became more akin to something violently crashing through the woods. At this point, I stopped what I was doing and shined my flashlight around to try and see what it was, figured maybe a cow or something had gotten loose, and couldn't see anything but was off put by the sound, so I started to pack in my stuff to leave when I heard some splashing followed by the sound of a very large crack. I turned and drew my gun while pointing my light at the fallen tree and there it stood. Koyu adrenaline dump. Everything went slow motion. This 6 feet-ish, tall thing with what seemed to me at the time the face of a wolf, but much too large to be a wolf or coyote. It was roughly as tall as I am, 6 feet, and as the light hit it, it paused and looked at me, growled, and charged at me. I fired 8 shots in quick succession before it barreled into me, knocking me flat, but rather than follow through on the attack, it kept trucking and disappeared into the cornfield. I got up and left the rest of my stuff, came back the next day to find the farmer, a couple sheriffs and a game warden. The farmer had sheep, and a couple had been killed the night before, and so he had been driving around setting up trail cams and stumbled upon my stuff, the weird trail of smashed corn, as well as some strange prints in the mud, and had called the game warden, and apparently the sheriffs were bored and came to check things out too. Told them about what I saw, and was told it was probably a bear, but the tracks were distinctly not bear tracks, so I don't believe it. It was 2013, October. I was down the shore and living in Point Pleasant. I went to Atlantic City for a day and stopped at a motel in Weirtown at the edge of the Pine Barrens in Cian Ocean County. That part of Ocean County is less built up than LBI or Point Pleasant or Seaside Heights. The motel was dirty and the owners said they were from Uzbekistan. I slept on towels in the bathroom because it looked like there were bedbugs. At around 2 a.m., I hear on the side door to my room exiting to the motel pool, a loud aggressive banging. Someone, or something is trying to break the door down. My first thought is it's drunk kids at the pool, but the pool was closed and covered because it's October. It's too big to be a kid, and it's making a noise that's halfway between children's laughter and snarling megafauna. The door sounds like it's gonna snap and I bolt to the hall. It stops. I was told it was the Jersey Devil, which the locals swear is real, and it has a habit of banging on sheds in Waretown, like the shed for the pool equipment. So I believe I heard the Jersey Devil and narrowly avoided being devoured by it. So this is actually both me and my mom's experience with what we believe was the Jersey Devil, but not at the same time. We had separate encounters. I'm still not sure what I saw, to be clear. But I don't want to experience it again either way. Anytime it comes up, I end up looking over my shoulder the rest of the day. It creeps me out. My mom grew up near Morristown, New Jersey during the 60s. She's a pretty skeptical person when it comes to anything supernatural, and I would say I am too. Not religious in the slightest, and I don't believe in ghosts, but after my own experience, I do accept that there are sometimes things you can't really explain. And I think she feels the same way based on our conversations, though it honestly creeps both of us out to talk about, so it doesn't really come up much. It's been a few years since we've talked about it, but from what I remember, Mom's experience from what she's told me is this: I think it was 1964 or 1965, so she would have been 10 or 11 at the time. For some background, she has two brothers and both were involved in Boy Scouts, but as the only girl she tended to feel left out when they'd go on campouts, etc. She was definitely a tomboy and didn't understand as the little sister why she couldn't also go camping with the boys. Luckily, my grandpa was pretty in tune to this and started including my mom where he could. He was a mechanical engineer and was a big proponent of practical, hands-on knowledge. Just because she was a girl didn't mean she wasn't going to learn how to change a tire or build a fire. In fact, she was the one who got me involved in Boy Scouts and still volunteers with my old troop 13 years after I've aged out, but I digress. Anyway, my grandpa started taking my uncles and her camping himself shortly after my uncles started Scouts. Prior to that, camping wasn't really a thing for them. My uncles didn't really care that much and Mom wasn't interested until she thought she was being excluded. Obviously, she'd get upset when my uncles would go on troop trips without her, but my grandpa did his best to give her the same types of experiences where he could. My grandparents tried to get her to join Girl Scouts, but I guess her issue was wanting to be with her brothers doing what they were doing. Not having a separate activity to go do on her own with the other girls. As I said, I think she was 10 or 11 and grandpa had taken my mom and uncles to some state park for some late summer overnight camping and canoeing. All I remember is it was some river. Vast River Forest sounds right after Googling, but to be honest I don't remember and I don't want to text her at 11 p.m. to ask lol. They spent the day paddling around in my grandpa's canoe near the campsite and then did the typical hot dogs on skewers and s'mores dinner before turning in for the night. Sometime during the night she woke up needing to pee. There were pit latrines on the edge of the campground, but with it being pitch black out she laid awake for what was prob 20 minutes but felt like hours from what she said needing to go pee. She finally got up the courage to go, or at least realized it was either that or wetting herself, unzipped the tent, and poked her way across the campsite to the latrine. She went to the bathroom, poked her way back across the campsite, and climbed back into the tent. As she turned around to zip the tent shut, she caught a glimpse of two red dots staring at her from around the side of the latrine she'd just come from. She said at first she just sat there staring, wondering what it was. Like, she thought it was brake lights from a car, but it was just woods behind the latrine, so she didn't understand what a car would be doing way over there. That is until they blinked and started moving very smoothly toward her. She said she zipped the tent up and crawled inside her sleeping bag and didn't move the rest of the night. They were camping right on the edge of the woods, so deer or other animals moving around at night isn't unusual. But she said the whole rest of the night she felt like something was slowly moving around their campsite, breathing. Any little twig breaking or leaf crunching had her terrified. But she didn't want to seem like a scared little girl and not get invited on any more trips, so she just stayed quiet and didn't wake my grandpa. She did say something to him the next morning and he joked, "Oh, the Jersey Devil?" As far as I know, that was the end of it. She insists it wasn't a deer because the eyes seemed to put off a red light of their own and moved so smoothly towards her like they were hovering. She didn't have a flashlight or anything, and other than the moon, it was a pretty dark night, so she doesn't believe it was just the reflection of a deer's eyes or something. So next up is my story. My grandparents lived in NJ until the early 2000s, so as a kid we'd go up there for Thanksgiving or Christmas to visit. Usually a couple times a year, once in the fall slash winter and once over the summer. On this particular trip, it was just after the 4th of July in 1999, I was 9. Our neighbors in VA had put on a neighborhood firework display, which I ended up hating because a hot ember came down on my chin that year and gave me a blister, but it has ingrained that particular 4th of July in my memory. So a couple days later we were up in NJ visiting and spent the trip swimming in my grandparents' pool as I tried to keep from knocking my burn blister open. It was a while after dinner one night and we're sitting out on the porch watching some stray fireworks that their neighbors were setting off. It was prob July 6th or 7th at this point, and the night was winding down. My grandma had gone up to bed and it was me, my dad, and my grandpa sitting out on the porch while my mom and sister were inside watching a movie. I remember it was a warm breezy night and you could smell the fireworks. My grandpa finally decides to head up after my grandma and my dad walks in the house behind him to grab another beer, so I was left on the porch on my own. The fireworks had died down a few minutes earlier, so I was about to follow my dad and when I heard a thump up on top of the house. I looked up over my shoulder and saw two red dots on the eave of the roof. I just sat there for a second thinking they were embers from the fireworks. But then they blinked. The area I live in has a very active deer population. They're constantly getting hit by cars at night in my area and people constantly have to be on the lookout for these dudes. So one night I'm driving home from my friend's house around 1 a.m. I'm going pretty slow because the place near my house has a pretty big deer family who loves the area, around 6 to 7 of them. So I'm driving up a hill going around 30 miles per hour and I had to slam on my brakes cause a deer runs in front of my car. I don't know if it was because it was super late at night and I was tired or what. But I kid you not, this was not a deer, one too many legs and one too many eyes. I only saw it for a second cause it ran past my car. But it was the weirdest thing I'd ever seen. I even looked it up later and there is a commonly seen cryptid called the Not a Deer, so that's just my fun little cryptid story. Mind you, not the only one, my friends and I have seen some weird stuff living where we do. It all started as a warm May night, May 28th to be exact. Nothing was out of the ordinary. My friends and I were playing video games on a school night, procrastinating homework and yelling at each other about some stupid problem in the game. We grew tired of playing video games, so I signed off for the night. I don't live far from a general store, so I thought I might as well hop on my bike, ride there to grab some cream soda and sunflower seeds. So I did. The bike ride usually takes around 10 minutes to get there. The bike ride consists of going through my neighborhood, a scary ass bike trail, then another neighborhood. So I put in my earbuds and rode there. I got all the way there just to realize I didn't have my wallet, very disappointing since it just was getting dark. I got back on my bike and started the ride back. Usually when I go back I cut through a backyard instead of taking the trail. It's mainly downhill on the way back, so I usually don't take the trail back. But for some reason I felt compelled to go down the trail, like a pull. When I was riding down the trail I heard a inhuman screech, I mean like a mix between a bald eagle and a human scream. I of course looked towards where the sound came from and I saw an extremely skinny, super pale, and very tall figure get on all fours and start running at me. When I say extremely skinny, I mean like it was skin and bones, and the legs and arms were super long. The face was nearly featureless besides for a mouth and two black eyes. I got the hell out of there as fast as my bike could handle. I know I wasn't just imagining it. I now have my license and refuse to go down that trail when it's remotely close to dark out. It was a late night last night. I paid the taxi and stumbled back into the apartment, trying to be quiet but managing to bang into damn near everything. Cringing at each thing I knocked over, I groped my way through the dark into my bedroom. It must have been 2, maybe 3 in the morning by this point. Bar was closed, that was for sure. I stripped to my boxers and tried to crawl into the bed as stealthily as I could. My girlfriend would definitely be pissed off at me getting home at this ungodly hour. She didn't stir, the blanket rising and falling slowly with her resting breaths. I slunk down onto the pillow, eyes droopy and breaths heavy. I was nearly passed out before I'd even touched the cool, silky sheets. I could feel the room spinning away into a dream when my phone began vibrating. I groggily rolled to the side of the bed, reaching for the rumbling hums. I looked at the screen. It was my girlfriend's number. She must have left it at a friend's house and they were calling my phone to let me know. I answered it. "Hello?" I slurred. "Hey babe, I just got home. Could you help me bring in the laundry?" "What?" That was my girlfriend's voice. "But..." I snapped my head to the huddled body laying next to me. My mind spewed infinite scenarios of what unimaginable horror awaited me under those sheets. My stomach in my throat, eyes wide with terror, I grabbed a handful of blanket and snatched it away from what it covered. She moaned into consciousness and stared at me, confused. I shined my phone in her face to see if she was some sunken-eyed specter. No, no. She just looked really pissed off. She saw my eyes wide and mouth open, stupidly. "You stupid drunken man. Go to sleep," she seethed and smacked me with a pillow. She kicked my side a few times, grumbled some obscenities, and flipped over towards the wall. Yep. Definitely my girlfriend. I must have hung up the phone because it began vibrating again in my hand. I jumped a bit, my nerves still a bit frayed. It was her number again. I answered it and she spoke again. "Hey babe, I just got home. Could you help me bring in the..." I hung up right away. It sounded exactly like her, but she was asleep right next to me. Her basket of clean clothes was in the corner, filled with folded things she hadn't put away today. I remember her bringing it home earlier, because she had called me this afternoon and I begrudgingly dragged it all up the stairs for her. I crawled over to the window and with 2 fingers, separated the blinds so I could peer through. I scanned the lot for her car and saw it nearly directly below our bedroom. It was weird. It looked like she was in the car, but the longer I watched, the more it sank in that there was something very, very off. Her neck seemed too long, her shoulders much too narrow, and her head too thin. Her face began to twist to the side, all the while a toothy grin stretched wider and wider until it was touching both her ears. Her large, shadowed eyes were staring straight forward into the steering wheel. Until suddenly her face snapped upwards, her black eyes wide and staring hungrily into my window. Her mouth began to open into an impossibly cavernous grin. She raised a gangly hand to her head. My phone began to vibrate once more. I had been staring in shock, in complete disbelief of what I was experiencing. The light buzzing in my hand jolted me back into reality. All the air left my lungs, I collapsed next to my girlfriend and shook her awake. Still in her tired stupor, I shook her harder, grabbed her by the arm, and pulled her to the window. "Babe," I whispered, nearly in tears, "look. Look inside your windshield." She looked around for her car, and then she saw it. "John, what the..." She began to speak, looking very worried. In a split second, it changed to a twisted grimace of pure terror, her suddenly bursting into a shrieking, hysterical sobbing. She shoved her head into my side, my arms pulling her close to my abdomen. Unable to look away from the window, I watched as the thing inside her car opened the door and power walked away, unnaturally quick. towards the forested lake to the left of the apartments. It kept its head turned towards me the whole time, its neck bending gruesomely backwards as the rest of its body strutted away. It wasn't grinning anymore, it was frowning. It almost looked sad. We must have tired ourselves out from all those surges of adrenaline-fueled fear, because right after it had walked away, I remember waking up in the daytime. My girlfriend was still tangled in my arms, us both slumped towards each other like the letter A. I checked my phone to see what time it was and saw that I had 16 missed calls, all between the time of 1 a.m. and 7 a.m. this morning. We hadn't tried calling each other since yesterday afternoon, before it all happened. I had no idea how her phone had been used like that, as it was plugged in next to her all night. There weren't any outgoing calls from her phone to mine. What's weirder though is that when she checked her phone, she also had 18 missed calls, but from my phone number. Each one, same as mine, was made between the time of 1 a.m. and 7 a.m. I didn't really know what to say about it to her. So I said, "Well, babe, I guess that means no more late night taco runs for a while." We didn't laugh. We spent the day of the 28th in a weird funk, both calling into work and consoling each other. We made sure to never be alone until we were positive things had blown over. That night I typed up everything that had transpired the day before. People seemed very interested, and we gleaned a few ideas from the many user comments. There were endless theories on what the creature could be, how we could combat it, how we could stay safe. A few things were clear. This thing was mimicking Megan and could potentially be mimicking me as well. It wasn't a nightmare fueled by alcohol, as all the proof was there in our phones and in her eyes that morning. Nothing odd happened that evening on the 28th. After I finished the story, I checked my phone and went to bed. We woke up the next day. No missed calls on either of our phones. Feeling a bit better, Megan went to work and said she'd be going to a friend's afterwards. That worked for me, seeing as I'd be at work for an evening shift until late. I didn't want her to be alone, and neither did she. Work went slow, customer faces coming and going in a painstakingly long blur. On my lunch, I grabbed a meal and went to text Megan, checking up on her. The screen stayed black. My phone was dead. I must not have plugged it in before I slept last night, an aggravating habit of mine that occurred all too often. I finished my food, went out back to have a smoke, and worried about my girlfriend. A few hours later, my shift was wrapping up. It was dead at that point, so I was able to leave a few minutes early. I raced home, flung open the door to the apartment, and jammed the charger into the phone. A few nerve-wracking minutes went by as the phone built up power. It lit up, the small Apple logo emblazoning the screen. I watched it intensely, waiting for the lock screen to appear, waiting to see if any nightmares had come true over the last 8 hours. The lock screen came up and I read the message on the front. 5 missed calls. Uh-oh. I went to dial call Megan back and got a shock when the phone began to buzz. Incoming call from Megan. Oh Christ, this is it. Let's see what's really going on here. I tentatively brought the phone to my ear and answered it. Hello? I whispered, shaking, expecting to hear something about laundry. Babe. It was her. I'm almost in the neighborhood. I got your call that you were leaving work early, but you hung up before I could say anything. I didn't know when to come home, and I didn't want to get there alone. You weren't answering your phone, so I just waited until you were off work. So chills shot up and down my spine. My voice, hoarse with sudden panic, screamed at her. No, my phone has been dead since I got to work. Turn around right now and go back to your friends. Stay there. She let out a little scream. I heard the squealing of tires in the background as her car pulled a U-turn. Oh my God. Babe, that means that it's there right now, she shrieked in panic. I know, Megan. I'm gonna be stuck here for tonight. You stay put, stay safe. Please. I love you. I love you too. I'm so scared, John. I'm so scared. Me too. With that, I hung up. I promptly went to the cabinet and took a shot. Then, another. I thought about what she'd just said. How it was here, right now, waiting somewhere for her to return. I went to the balcony and moved the blinds open a little. Nothing seemed out of the ordinary. It started to dawn on me that something had called her this time, mimicking me. That meant there was either one thing trying to fool both of us, or two things targeting us singly. I looked towards my car, anxious as to what I'd witness. It was parked farther down in the apartment complex and I couldn't really see anything from the window. I sure as hell wasn't going to go out and check, either. The couple drinks I'd had put me in a fuzzy, sleepy state. Not drunk, just overwhelmingly tired. I texted Megan, making sure everything was okay, and passed out in my bed. It wasn't good sleep at all. I jerked awake every hour or so in my bed for no reason. Each time I awoke, I would check my phone. No missed calls. I turned the phone to a ring setting so that a call would wake me up, in case Megan had an emergency. I'd check the phone and drift back off into an uneasy sleep. Wake up. Repeat. This kept going until 4 a.m. this morning when my phone made a loud beep. Megan had texted me. Hey, I'm just gonna head home now. Nothing weird happened and I work in 4 hours. See you soon. What was she doing? I had explicitly told her to stay where she was. It wasn't worth the risk to sleep in a familiar bed. If she was tired, she could goddamn call into work. She was running the risk of running into that monster outside her car door. Seriously, what was she thinking? I called her, no answer. Again, no answer. I texted her telling her to turn back around. She didn't pick up or respond to anything I sent her. I did this for about 20 minutes when my phone rang. It was her. I answered it and spat, "What are you doing? Get away from the apartment." There was a pause, and then the most blood-curdling shrieks I've ever heard came through the speaker of my phone. It was Megan's voice. Megan's screams of terror. It went on for a few moments until she bawled, "Oh my God, please help me, it got me. It got me." The terrifying words replayed in my head, endlessly. It got me. I jumped up instinctually, dropping the phone to the ground. I flung the bedroom door open, grabbed a bat from the closet, and stomped out the front door into the apartment complex hallway. Every qualm I'd had against facing this thing had disappeared the moment I got that call. I was trembling in rage. It had Megan, the girl of my dreams, the kind of woman that made a life worth living. I was going to destroy this creature. I was going to stare into its ogling black eyes until I saw the terror that it had once instilled in me. It would fear me as I once feared it. And when that hopeless, soul-absorbing fear flashed across its gaze, I would beat it until there was nothing left but a stain on the concrete. I walked out of the apartment into the cool night air. The wind was calm, everything was still. Gripping the bat tightly in my hands, I stalked between cars in the parking lot, calling out for Megan. My eyes darted to and fro, scanning the vehicles for Megan's red sedan. Searching for her. Searching for it. I must have walked the perimeter 3 times before I realized that Megan's car wasn't there. She wasn't here. Thoughts raced in my head. They'd found her at her friend's home. They caught her while on the road. She could be anywhere. A sinking feeling of fear overpowered me. What if she hadn't called me at all and this was a trap? For me. Any bravado I had disappeared. I ran towards my car, dropping my bat while fumbling with the car keys. I stood outside the door for a moment, fingers trembling, trying to find the right key. I looked up to unlock the car when I saw someone staring back at me. It was that same sinking feeling in your gut when you almost fall backwards out of a chair. That sudden jolt to your consciousness. My first thought was that it had gotten in my car and was waiting for me. I did a double take and looked at the person. My fear subsided a bit when I realized it was Megan. She must have gotten into my car to escape whatever was after her. Her face was normal, her green eyes, the narrow chin. It was really her. I yanked open the door and told her to hop into the passenger seat, but she didn't budge. She looked at me and smiled. Something felt off again. She opened her mouth and spoke to me, "I'm so scared, John. I love you too. I just waited until you were off work." Each sentence she spoke was disjointed, the inflection varying wildly. From each punctuated phrase. One of fear, one of anxiety, one normal. Her lips didn't match the words coming out. I stepped back to the end of the car, horrified by the obvious. This wasn't Megan. I'd been duped. Its trick had worked. It got me. A long thin leg emerged from the open door as it pulled itself from the seat. Each limb was contorted, lanky and stretched. It stood up, a foot taller than me. It continued to smile as it began screeching, those same panicked words that I had heard from the phone. The same shrieks of exasperated fear that my girlfriend had made minutes ago. Its lips, moving at their own pace, continued to scream at a disjointed speed. Megan's familiar face, watching me, plastered onto an unfamiliar monster. I hadn't moved that whole time. There just aren't the right kind of words to explain what ran through my head. It was empty, blank, devoid of analysis. I just watched, unable to function as she towered over me. It took a step forward at the same frightening, unnatural speed as days prior. That movement jolted me back to my senses. In half a second she stood 6 inches away from me, her neck craned over my head, staring directly downwards into my eyes. I didn't scream. I couldn't. I stumbled backwards, turned tail, and sprinted faster than I ever have before in my entire life. As I ran towards the apartment door, I heard nothing behind me except those painful screams. No footsteps, no panting, no sounds that would indicate a speedy chase. That run felt like forever, my feet clomping loudly, punctuated by the shrieks. On the last stretch, stupidly, I turned my neck around to catch an eye at what was behind me. It was right there. That was when screams began pouring out of my throat. I screamed wildly, uncontrollably loud. Each sprinting step I took, it took 5, small, shuffling steps to match. It moved like a cassette tape on fast forward. Each movement a blur, each stride a jittery shake. Its footsteps made no sound, it didn't breathe, it was unnaturally silent except for the screams from its chattering lips. I swung open the door, jumped the steps 4 at a time, and locked myself in the apartment. Darkness. Emptiness. Maniacal screeching behind the 4 inches of wood between my apartment and the hallway. I looked through the peephole and almost threw up. On the other side, a big green eyeball was staring back in. It had followed me up. It was outside my apartment. I went in my room and cried for the rest of the night, gasping sobs escaping at each tiny thump I heard. There were no calls on my phone, no texts, nothing. I sat against the wall, knees tucked up under my neck, shaking. I stared at the phone until the night took me to sleep. That was last night, or very early this morning, I guess. I woke screaming to the sun filtering through my window. I stumbled to the bathroom and opened it. Nothing. The closet. Nothing. I checked every nook, every little hiding spot that I knew existed in the apartment. Nothing, nothing, nothing. I crept to the front door, shivering as I raised an eye to the peephole. Nothing. I swung open the blinds to the balcony and stepped outside. There was nothing but a few neighbors leaving for their morning commute. No screams, no gangly doppelgangers. There was just nothing. Still very upset, I went back in the room and checked the phone. I had one missed text message from Megan. Oh, thank God, I sighed in relief. She was okay. Through all of that happened just a few hours ago, she was okay. I looked at the message. Nothing weird's happened and I see you soon. I threw the phone at the wall and broke down once more. At the time of writing this last sentence, which is 7:38 p.m., she still hasn't come home. That is what worries me the most, because if these things can only mimic things they've seen or heard from us, then what had happened to Megan to make her scream like that for so long? When I was 14 or so in 2003, I saw what looked like an orangutan slash lemur hybrid watching me from the trees. When it realized I was looking at it, it took off into the trees and disappeared. This was in Western NC, nothing like that should have been around here. For a few years I looked for articles about someone's escaped exotic pet but never found anything. eventually just wrote it off. Years later, I heard a lore episode about the Pukwudgie and I immediately got chills because the description matched what I saw. I'm still not sure what happened. Few months ago, I was dumb enough to wander into the same patch of woods. I got nailed by a rock, and when I looked up, I saw a small outline ducking around like it was watching my reaction. Again, when it recognized I was looking at it, it took off. I don't know what happened, but I also don't really plan on going back. One night I was driving home at around 2 a.m. and this tiny, tiny white creature, probably as tall as a Pringles can, though maybe a bit smaller, walked across the road in front of my car. I couldn't believe what I saw, so I called my then boyfriend and frantically described the creature. He told me that it sounded like the Fresno Nightcrawler, and when I got home and looked it up, that is exactly what it looked like. I had never heard about them before. I do not live in California, not even close. I still have no clue what it was. Some more details about what I saw, because I hadn't thought about this in a while, but now it's coming back to me. The bottoms of its legs ended in what looked like flowy bits or ribbons, and it was almost translucent. I could almost see the road through the creature. It walked at a kind of jaunty pace, just like a person might walk. The best way to describe it is like that super steppy walk that the dwarves sometimes do in Snow White, or Mickey Mouse does sometimes. I slowed my car down but was afraid to stop it completely, and the thing disappeared as my car went through it. Honestly, it was so damn cute that I wasn't even scared, but I was shaken up by having seen something like this. Hope that helps. About 18 years ago, my wife and I were looking out at Brickell Bay in Miami, Florida, when we saw a humanoid-looking creature wearing what looked like a black rubbery environmental suit just effortlessly gliding through the water waist deep. I shouted, "Do you see it? There." Pointing at it so my wife would see it about 50 feet in front of us on a bright sunny afternoon. It looked at us and then started submerging as it quickly headed for the bank until it went under it and out of view. It looked like it was wearing all black futuristic high-tech equipment, and the really strange part was the bay was over 10 feet deep at the bank, so somehow it could glide through the water with its upper body above the surface. Afterwards, we both were both in shock and our hearts were racing, beating out of our chests. It had big black eyes and a small nose and mouth. We called it the creature from the Black Lagoon. A ghost. Friend was at our place for a sleepover as kids, bedtime, both lying on mattresses in my room. Suddenly, this transparent, greenish-hued man slowly came in from the window and kind of just hovered in the air above us for a good 10-20 seconds, then slowly evaporated. I'd call it a dream, but after a moment of silence, my friend asked if I had seen it too. We put the lights on after that. On that note, had an incident with an Ouija board later in life as a teen that kind of spooked me out too. We had two people using the board and a third asking questions to prove it worked, and it actually gave answers we shouldn't have known. Something like me asking the other two my distant relative's dog's name and them getting it right despite it 100% never having come up before. It ended up acting incredibly strange by the end, and we burned it out of fear. Walking through the woods for fun, I walked through a field where there were tiny fluorescent jellyfish-like things floating through the air. Maybe half an inch to 2 inches in size. I initially thought it was some kind of plant spores or something moving in the wind, but when I looked at them closer, they were actually moving independently. That was about 2006. I spent months going through those woods and that field over and over again with a camera trying to find them, but I've never seen them since. I used to go running and take a break at a train bridge in Iowa City when I went to school there. I did a lot of night runs. Sometimes, only after dark, I'd hear something swimming around at that train bridge. Maybe human or deer-sized. One time, it was late and I heard it again. But this time, I could see something dark on the water. Looked like a profile of a very large head. I said, "Hello, someone there?" It stopped dead still and looked at me. It was dark, but I could tell it was looking right at me. This went on for 30 seconds or a minute. It then went under, and I never saw or heard it again. I told myself it was a person swimming. But why not say hi back? Also, where did it go under to? It was a slow river. I would have heard it surfacing or getting out of the water unless it went over 100 feet. That's the closest thing to a cryptid I've seen and known about. Some people are saying beavers and otters. I've seen river otters, but not in the US. It was far too big to be a normal sized one. I've never seen the 6 feet ones, and I don't think they live anywhere near Iowa. It was much too big to be a beaver too. I see those all the time, and they're usually denoted by telltale signs such as dams and chewed trees. Also, I've never seen beavers active at night, only during the day. I think it was probably just a person, maybe a homeless person who wanted to not be bothered by me. As I said, that's the closest I've come to seeing a cryptid. I know the original post asked for people that are 100% sure, but it was late at night and it felt appropriate to tell that story. This was back in the late 90s when myself and two of my friends were staying at their vacation home down on one of the local rivers. The house, think three small bedrooms, a sitting room slash kitchen, and a small external bathroom, is on a privately owned island, not theirs, which is used for cattle grazing, and is about 3 to 4 square/miles in area. It is accessible by only one dirt road, which takes all of about 30 minutes to travel down, as it bends and winds through dense cypress swamps, full of alligators, and marsh plains. Along the road, there is one other house, just as you get onto the island, which has long been abandoned. This old two-story plantation-style home was supposedly abandoned when the owners, a married couple, child suffered a fatal accident, and they couldn't stand being there anymore. Aside from my friend's house, the cattle farmer's home, and one other vacation home, the abandoned property is the only other structure. Well, my friends and I were out on the dock doing some night fishing, trying to land a shark or something to throw on the grill, but we hadn't had much luck. The river was as smooth as glass, which was really unusual, because of where the dock is, the current there is usually very strong, even during the tide shift. We sat and chatted, waiting for a bite, up until about 11 p.m., then off to our right, towards the coast, we heard a loud tone or wail, which sounded like a mix between a ship's horn and maybe a wolf howl or something similar. An important note, the island is, by car, nearly an hour from deep water access, and probably more from actual ocean, so the likelihood that the sound was a large ship is low. So anyway, we are startled by the sound, and even my friend, who had been spending his summers there since he was in diapers, had never heard the noise before, and was bothered by it. So we decide to pack it in, since we weren't catching anything anyway, and had nearly gotten all our equipment back to the house when my second friend heard it. Coming from down the road, back towards the island access, was what sounded either like a cat meowing or a child crying. We all stood in silence listening, and trying to figure out what it was, and where it was coming from. After listening for about 5 minutes, we decide to hop in the truck and drive down the road a ways, with the windows down so we can try and find what was making the sound. What started out sounding like a cat, was made clear as we got further up the road, that was not the case. We could clearly hear a child and it sounded like it was saying help me. We drove very slowly calling out, and we'd wait a few minutes and hear help me again, but always further up the road, towards the swamps and the old abandoned house. We were seriously freaked out, because if there was a kid out there, why would they be going away from our calls and light into the swamp? We nearly made it all the way to the abandoned house when the sound just stopped. We waited for nearly an hour, and never heard it again. We marked it up as nerves, and headed back to the river house, assuming it had been an animal after all, and that we were probably just imagining it saying words. Well, after we had gotten back inside, and settled in for the night, we started hearing it again, but as time passed, it came closer to us. We went out and called out again, and the sound would come closer. This went on for hours. Well, we decided, we would try one more time to see if there was a kid lost or something. Again, important to note, we are miles from the next nearest people, and the noise sounded like a child, think 4-year-old, but once we got out in the truck again, the noise stopped. It's now nearly 3 in the morning, and we had been out in the sun fishing and swimming all day, so we were all tired, and after driving around a bit, calling out again, with no luck we decide to give up. We get back inside again, and get into our beds. Then we hear it, clear as a bell, help me right outside the house, but it sounded so strange, like it was an echo, if that makes sense, like it was close but far away too. And like hell if any of us were brave enough to go commando, and leave the house, but we went out onto the porch, which was screened in for bugs, and listened. As soon as we went out, it would stop. Go back into the beds, it would call out again, but in a different location outside the house. It circled the house, calling, all night. We all slept in the living room, but to be honest, there wasn't a lot of sleeping happening. In the morning we went out and looked for tracks around the house, as the foundation is basically sand. There wasn't a mark, no prints, animal or otherwise, and to the best of my knowledge, this never happened again to my friend or any other visitors. To this day we don't know what we heard, but it's probably the most supernatural occurrence I've experienced. I was on a ferry for a school softball trip, off Kodiak Island, aka 2014. I was 18. A whole bunch of us had snuck up to the deck around 11 p.m. to watch the waves and smoke cigarettes and weed and generally be teenagers on a boat without supervision. It was 11 p.m. in May in Alaska, so the sun was thinking about setting, but it was still pea bright outside. So we're just doing our thing and we notice a pod of orcas swimming with the ferry's wake, which is very cool but not, like, unusual. If you're familiar with the dimensions of an orca fin, you know they're about 4 to 6 feet in height and look like big black spikes coming out of the water. They travel and hunt in pods of anywhere between 15 to 40 whales. Apex predators. The beautiful demon murderers of the sea. Total assholes. Top of the food chain. So we saw a pod of orcas, counted them to be around 10-15, with some babies scattered in there. Very fun to watch, took them a good 30 minutes to all go by. We tried to get pictures, but it was just dark enough that our phone cameras weren't much good. Another 30 or 40 minutes go by and we've all pretty much sobered up and it's about to get dark and we're cold and sleepy and about ready to go in. No more orcas, haven't seen one for like half an hour, and then one of my JV girls spots another one. So we all turn and look, but one dorsal fin is immediately followed by another and another and another and then two more, and then two more after that, in two separate rows, and they're taller, by a lot, and jagged, like some have whole chunks torn out of them, and they're all 8 to 10 feet high. And they're all attached to one creature, and we can just barely see its back slicing through the water, covered in these rows of spikes, and it just keeps coming. This thing is like 20 or 30 feet from the ferry, running parallel to it, and we are all transfixed. There's like 9 or 10 of us and no one is saying a word because we've all turned to look at a whale and we are all now watching something that is like, horrifically, terrifyingly obviously not a whale. Someone tries to take a picture but it's too dark at this point and the only reason we can see this thing is the light cast from ferry portholes. Take as old as time when it comes to things that you really wish you had a picture of. But we all stand there completely scared stiff and in awe and we watch this thing just keep surfacing for a good 6 or 7 minutes which means that whatever it was long. Like 60 or 70 feet long. Or longer. And covered in enormous spikes. Spikes that looked like they'd won thousands of battles with God knows what. It took what felt like an eternity for any of us to say anything after the last of it disappeared back into the strait. I mean if you and like 8 of your friends had just all seen something that all science had definitely pointed to not existing, and you had all seen the same exact thing, and it was very obviously trailing, nay, hunting, not one but 15 something apex predators. What do you even say to break that silence? That's the thing that eats me about the whole thing, is it was hunting. It was following them. It was literally hunting about 60 tons of toothy, angry, intelligent apex predator. Every once in a while one of us will hit another one of us up and check in, like do remember this. Was I hallucinating? Did we all see the same, insane, worldview melting, terrifying thing that night? And the reason I know we did is BC none of us talked about it after that, not during the trip, not after, not to any of our friends BC how do you even tell someone about something like that? Now we have almost 10 years between us and that night I assume some of them have probably told people. I know I tell people, because I've seen a lot of things like that in Alaska and I'm that bitch. And also BC, there's a very rich history among native Alaskans of a something that lives and hunts in the waters around Kodiak, and it's important to tell its story. BC, someday it's gonna eat a little too much plastic and no one will ever watch it hunt a pod of orcas from a boat ever again. My wife and I were in the UK for our honeymoon and traveling the M6 from London to Edinburgh. We were several hours into the trip, mid-afternoon, and my wife had dozed off and was napping in the passenger seat. Just north of Penrith and still south of the Scottish border, I saw a giant cat off to my right, clear as day, hunting sheep. I say hunting because I literally saw it ducking behind hay and then pouncing over the hay to attack a sheep in the -10 seconds I was able to see it given the speed we were traveling. It was a light tan, almost white, color and easily the size of a puma. Pretty shocked at what I was seeing, I shook my wife awake. She had to crane her neck out the passenger window, and then the back rear window, to see it, but was able to eventually locate it right as it pounced on the sheep. We looked at each other with a WTF did we just witness. Looked and debated on whether to turn around and have a closer look. We didn't see a quick turnaround anywhere on the highway and decided to carry on given that we were on pace to arrive at our destination after dark. Other than thinking it was cool to see nature in action, we didn't think much else of it until years later when we heard a podcast, I think Joe Rogan, where a guest mentioned an English cat cryptid. Unbeknownst to us Americans, rather embarrassingly, big cats are not native to the UK. We did another WTF look at each other when we heard that particular fact and now know that we were even luckier than we first imagined. Still amazed by it all these years later. When I was super young, like maybe 10 or 11, I was in little league baseball that my dad coached. One of the fields we played on was behind a school that was in the middle of a suburb, with a small forest on one side. I remember playing on the park that was at the school because the game was over, and I looked over to the trees to see a lady, maybe 5 to 6 feet tall, wearing a think black zip-up hoodie. Looked maybe 20 years old. She was running into the forest holding her hands on her face, and I distinctly remember clear as day that she had cat eyes, like creepily oversized yellow eyes that resembled a cat. I was very young, so honestly I've just chalked it up to me having an overactive imagination, but the memory of her is so clear, even with the eyes. I was like 9 to 10 years old at the moment. In my country there is this festival in which a goddess is worshipped every evening for 9 days, you can guess where I might be from by that. We and a bunch of friends were playing around in front of the worship place away from the crowd. Everyone was focusing on the rituals. All of this was happening in my neighborhood, and we all basically knew each other very well, like a big whole family. Then me and the boys saw something or someone in black approaching from a distance. He was quite far away. For some reason we decided to chase that person, kids, you know. The man realized we were coming after him with like 2 German shepherds. He started running. When I got like a few feet behind him, I realized that he was completely black. Like, I am not talking about the skin color but the whole appearance, like a shadowy figure. I was stunned after that glacé and froze at the spot, shocked. My friends kept running believing they were after a thief or a robber. He took the only turn leading to a long path. One of my friend, the fastest runner, took the turn and the man wasn't there. Right before the man vanished, most of the boys knew why I was frozen despite being so close. A little bit more about the man. Was in that appeared to be casual clothes and 5 feet tall. He was completely black in appearance as he had passed like 5 street lights and as if light wasn't affecting his appearance. We still talk about that incident to this day. I grew up in Central Oregon, and there's a reservation called Warm Springs about 2 or so hours from where I lived. I only mention that because a lot of people in my area have friends there, and a lot of the land in that area belongs to that tribe. When I was a kid, we used to go camping up there. Not on the Rees, of course, but in that area, and I met a lot of kids who grew up there. I got to know one kid really well. His name was Nolan, and we ended up hanging out a lot when our families were in the area. Our folks got to know each other so we'd all get in touch and camp out around the same time. We'd camp for about 2 weeks, so we were out there for a long time. I asked him if he camped in an RV. Yeah, my dad had one, so I guess it wasn't really camping, but we'd take our tents and stuff and set them up out away from camp most nights. I didn't like sleeping in there because I like being outside. We talked for a bit about camping. So anyway, sorry, 1 year Nolan and I were out there. I think we must have been like 12 or so. We wanted to go out and camp near the river because we wanted to try night fishing. I think we must have been about a third of a mile from the main camp. Far enough away that we couldn't hear or see anyone else, I remember that. We were messing around most of the day. I don't really remember much about it, but we ended up building a fire at some point and I was really impressed because he had this flint or something that he used to start it. I'd never seen anyone do that before, so I thought it was pretty cool. I got him to teach me how to do it and we lit some stuff on fire, which looking back was really stupid because it was the middle of summer, and if I remember right the fire warning was either at yellow or orange. But thankfully we didn't start anything major, and when it got dark we sat around and talked about whatever it is 12-year-olds talk about. I don't really remember. What I do remember is that at some point, he looked over my shoulder at the river and asked me if I could see something. The way our camp was set up, we were about 10 feet from the river, and we were at the widest point, so it was probably about 20 feet to the other bank. It gets hot up there in the summer but the water's still cold, which is important. I look over my shoulder and I could see something wading into the river on the other side. From where we were it looked like a deer but we couldn't really tell because of the fire. I got up to look closer and I saw a pair of antlers, so I figured it was a buck. But I thought it was weird that it was wading into the water, and it was definitely heading for us, and I asked Nolan what he thought we should do. He's looking at the fire with this weird expression and he tells me to sit down and shut up. So I do, because I'd never seen him act that way before. He's whispering at me to ignore it, and to just keep talking like we were, but I couldn't think of anything to say. He was saying something about an episode of some show, but I could hear the deer coming through the water, so I wasn't really paying any attention, and I kept trying to see over his shoulder, but every time I did he'd sort of hit me on the arm and make me look at him. I wasn't really scared, I remember, I was just sort of confused. But then I hear the deer come out of the water, and I could kind of make out what it looked like, and I realized it wasn't a deer because whatever it was walking on two legs. I started to get up, I was super freaked out, but Nolan just yanked me back down and talked louder about this television show, and I could tell he was just as scared as I was, probably even more. He leaned in and poked the fire with a stick, and he whispered that whatever I do, I can't speak to it. I could see it come closer and it stood right behind Nolan's back. I was about ready to pee my pants, and I think I'd probably have run if I'd been alone, but I didn't want to leave Nolan so I kept sitting really still and sneaking glances at it. It wasn't that tall, but the way it carried itself was just wrong, like its center of balance was screwed up. I can't really describe it, but it was kind of like it kept shifting too far forward. It just stood there behind Nolan for a long time, and eventually Nolan ran out of things to say and we just kind of sat there for a second. The fire was making noise, but I thought I could hear this thing talking in a really low voice. I couldn't hear what it was saying, and I leaned forward a tiny little bit, and I actually did pee my pants when it leaned forward too. I couldn't see its face, but I saw its eyes. They were cloudy and milky, and if you want to know what they looked like, find that scene from Lord of the Rings where Frodo falls in that lake and all the dead people are floating toward him. That's what its eyes looked like. So all I saw were these two white eyes floating above Nolan's head, and the really vague shape of the antlers coming out of its head. I don't know what my face looked like, but at exactly the same time Nolan and I booked it out of there, and we ran nonstop until we got back to the main camp. My pants were soaked with pee, so I took them off as we were running and threw them in the bushes. We both stopped once we were in front of my dad's RV and we couldn't see anything chasing us, so we stood there and caught our breath. I asked him what that thing was, but he said he didn't know. He said his grandpa had only warned him that if anything ever came up to him when he was out in the desert, he was never, ever supposed to talk to it or listen to anything it had to say. I wanted to know if he'd heard it talking to, and he said that the only thing he'd been able to understand was help you. I think we ended up sleeping in the RV with my parents, and the next night we went back out and didn't see anything. We were having dinner in town, five of us including myself. This guy, he was repainting an information booth and heard a man ask him for directions to the nearest campsite. He didn't turn around because he was up on a ladder, but he informed the man that there weren't any campsites nearby, but that if he headed down the road about 4 miles, he'd find one at another park. He asked if he could be of any other help, but the man said no and thanked him. My friend said he kept painting, but he was listening and never heard the man leave. The second he came up and talked to me, the hairs on my neck stood up, but I wasn't sure why. I just had this really uneasy feeling about the whole thing, and I wanted to finish painting and get out of there. I figured maybe part of it was that I couldn't turn around to look at him, but something just felt off. There was also this weird smell floating around even before the guy talked to me, kind of like old period blood. I had looked around to see what was causing it, but I didn't find anything. So I waited for the guy to walk away, but I didn't hear him leave, which made me think he was just standing there and watching me, so I asked again if I could do anything for him, and he didn't answer. I knew he was there though, because I hadn't heard him leave, so I did this awkward turn on the ladder to look down and see what he was doing. Now I admit it could have just been my brain mess up, but I swear to you, Russ, for a split second when I turned around, that man didn't have a face. Like he had no face. It was almost concave, and totally smooth, and I just about had a heart attack because I couldn't even wrap my brain around what I was seeing. I think I started to say something, but there was this kind of pop inside my head, and suddenly he was just a normal looking guy. I must have looked weird because he asked me if I was okay, and I was just like, yeah, I'm fine. He asks about the campsite again and I point to where he has to go, and he's like, I'm not from around here, can you help me get there? Now this is when I know something is really up because there's no way this guy got out here and didn't know where he was. And for that matter, there's no car around, so how did he get here in the first place? I said I was sorry but that I couldn't take him anywhere in a company vehicle, and he's like, please? I really don't know where I am, can you come with me and help me get there? So now I'm seriously weirded out, and I start wondering if this is some kind of ambush or whatever. I told him I could call him a taxi to come out and take him where he wants to go, and I pull out my phone and he just goes no and walks away really quickly. But he doesn't walk out of the park, he walks back into the trees and I got right in my truck and start to get out of there, the paint or whatever. I looked in my mirror to see where he was as I was leaving and he was standing right at the tree line again. I don't know how he got there so fast, but this time I know that he didn't have a face. He was just watching me leave, and right before I turned the corner he took a big step back into the trees and kind of dissolved, I guess. Maybe it was just dark so he blended in, but it felt more like he just melted away. Interestingly, right after this guy finished his story, someone else piped up with another one, but with a slightly different twist. You know, actually, I had something sort of weird like that happen a while back. I was out doing some trail scouting, and I was out in the middle of nowhere figuring out where we were gonna have this trail run through. I hadn't seen anyone else for probably a good 2 hours, so I wasn't really paying attention to where I was going. I was just looking at the ground for the most part. Then out of nowhere, I crested this little hill and almost ran into this guy. He was older, probably in his 60s, and I started to apologize to him for running into him. And then I noticed his face, and I probably looked like a complete douchebag because I stopped and just stared at him. It took me a second to figure out what was wrong, but this guy's face was huge. I know that sounds weird, but that's the only way I can describe it. His head wasn't big or anything, it was normal, but the amount of space his face took up was just way too much. Like if you took someone's face and enlarged it all by about 2 times. He doesn't say anything, he just kind of looks at me, and I backed up and was kind of stuttering and saying I was sorry, and I went around him and got out of there and did what I needed to do. The whole time, I kept looking behind me because I was so freaked out that he'd pop up behind me or something. I know it sounds ridiculous, but I swear to you, it was one of the creepiest things I've ever seen. I switched the topic to the stairs a little later, and there was a definite shift in enthusiasm. No one spoke up at first. There is a real stigma around discussing them, even when we're away from work. But I broke the ice with a story of my own, and the guy who told the story about the faceless man told this one, albeit very quietly. A couple years ago, I was camping with my girlfriend, and we're out about 2 miles from the road at this site I know. We went to bed that night, but we couldn't sleep because someone interjected a funny comment, and we were dangerously close to going off on another subject, but I got us back on track. Yeah, really funny, you. No, it was because we kept hearing that grinding noise. My brother used to grind his teeth in his sleep, and it kind of reminds me of that. My girlfriend was freaking out, but I just kept telling her to ignore it because I've heard it before and you just have to ignore it. It goes away eventually, you guys know what I mean. We all knew what he meant. So eventually I got her to go to sleep, but I woke up probably 2 hours later because something was just off. I rolled over and she wasn't there, and I kind of freaked out, because he thought for a second and then he took a very long drink. Anyway, I ran out of the tent calling her name, but I didn't have to go far. She was standing at the edge of the camp looking at something in the trees and I could see she was really pale. The fire was low but bright enough to see her. Anyway, so I ran up to see what was going on and she was dead asleep, but her eyes were open. She had this real spaced out look, you know. So I put my arm around her to lead her back, but she wouldn't move. She just said really quietly something like, I have to go now, Eddie. I have to go, it's here. I was like, you were just sleepwalking, come back to bed, but she wouldn't budge. She just kept standing there and saying that she had to go. And I looked where she was looking, and there was a staircase right there about 15 yards away. Gray one, concrete. And she started to walk toward it, but I yanked her back and that woke her up. She looked at me like I was out of my mind, and she asked what she was doing out of the tent. I didn't tell her anything, I just told her she was sleepwalking. The grinding was gone, so she just went back to the tent with me and fell asleep again. I don't know. I don't like thinking about it, you know? We all knew. You guys remember that kid with, I can't remember what it was, some kind of brain mess up, not Downs but something like it. Someone else brought up. Well, I got to read the report he gave when they found him a week after he went missing and it was beyond belief. I mean, you have to take it with a grain of salt because who knows what that kid actually thinks is real, but some of this stuff, I don't think he could have made up. Like what? Well, first of all, he talked about the stairs. He said he'd been watching his dad build a fire and the stairs came up to him, and he had to go up them or something bad would happen. The cops couldn't really understand what he was talking about after that, because he just kept saying like the campfire over and over. And he kept mentioning sounds, but he couldn't say what sounds, just that it was loud, and he covered his ears so he couldn't hear them. But the thing I remember most is that they asked him where exactly he'd gone, and he just said he was right there. He kept pointing at himself, and they said they thought that meant that he thought he'd never left. He said he wasn't scared because the stairs were there and he said they talked to him, but not like people talk. Like I said, it was really convoluted and hard to understand, and I have a feeling the cops didn't take most of it down. They ended up just saying that the kid had some kind of amnesia or fugue, and that they didn't think foul play was involved. Doesn't really explain why he came back a week later perfectly fine without a speck of dirt on him and well fed, but hey, what the cops say goes. Jackie Lincoln is a vet who's been a park ranger officer for about 15 years. She specializes in high elevation mountain rescues, and is widely considered one of the best in her field. She was one of the more enthusiastic storytellers, and since we were together a fair amount during exercises, she ended up telling me about four that really stuck with me. The first she told me in response to my asking about her most traumatic calls. She shook her head and told me that really bad calls happen more frequently on the mountain, since the potential for nasty accidents is higher. About 5 years ago, one of the parks she worked at had a string of disappearances. It was a bad year, she said, one of the worst on record as far as weather went. They were getting about a foot of new snow every couple of days, and there were a few avalanches that killed some climbers. They'd warned people about staying on the mapped areas, but of course there's always those who don't listen. In one particularly nasty case, an entire family got wiped out because the father decided he knew better than the officials, and he took them out into an area that wasn't safe. They were snowshoeing, and as best she could figure, they'd walked onto a shelf of snow that looked solid, but actually wasn't. It gave way, and this family went ass over tea kettle almost 300 feet down a slope. They landed on the rocks at the bottom, and the parents died instantly. One of the kids did as well, but the other two survived. One had a broken leg and fractured ribs, the other was almost unharmed save for some bruising and a sprained ankle. The uninjured child left his sibling behind and set out to find help. Jackie said the kid didn't make it more than half a mile before a storm overtook him. Kid stopped to try and get warm, or maybe just to rest, and ended up freezing to death. They ended up finding the family with the help of some witnesses who saw them heading out into the wilderness, and she was the one to find the kid who'd frozen to death looking for help. She said it had started to snow, just enough to obscure long-distance vision, but not enough to make searching impossible. She saw a figure sitting in the snow up ahead, and she got to it as quickly as possible. She described, in detail, how as she got closer, she realized first that it was a child, second that they were deceased, and third that they had frozen in one of the most pitiful positions she's ever found a corpse in. The kid was sitting upright, with his knees tucked up against his chest. His arms were curled around them, and his head was tucked up in his coat. When she moved the coat to look at his face, she saw that he died crying. His face was twisted, and the tears were frozen on his cheeks. She said it was painfully obvious that the kid was terrified when he succumbed to hypothermia, and as a mother, it broke her heart. She told me, repeatedly, that she hopes the father is burning in hell as we speak. The other traumatic story she told me that stood out, in my mind, was one that happened when she was a rookie. Her team got a report of an experienced climber who hadn't come home the previous day. His wife was convinced that something bad had happened, because he'd never failed to come home on time. They went out looking for him, and had to climb what sounded like some very technically challenging parts of the mountain. They got to a relatively flat area, and Jackie started seeing blood in the snow. She followed the trail, and as she went, she started seeing little bits of tissue. She wasn't sure exactly what body part it had come from, but the farther she followed it, the more there was. She follows this blood and tissue trail to a sheltered area under a cliff face, and she finds the climber. She said there was so much blood, more than she'd ever seen before. He was lying face down, one arm stretched in front of him, as if he'd died crawling. She looks closer, and sees that he's been partially disemboweled, which is where the tissue she'd seen had come from. The guy has an ice pick tucked into a hip holster, and it's covered in blood. Of course, they'll never be sure exactly what happened, but she said as best she can figure, this is what went down. The guy had been attempting to climb up to the next area, and had been using his ice axe to ascend. He'd probably hit a loose patch, and had fallen. On the way down, or possibly when he landed, he'd gotten impaled by the axe, and it had disemboweled him. He'd drug himself along, tearing pieces of himself out as he went, and had died under the cliff face. She isn't terribly bothered by gore, but I guess a few of the guys who came to help her remove the body threw up when they turned him over and a good portion of his intestines spilled out. I mentioned to her that I was interested in hearing about any experiences she had with people completely disappearing. Her eyes light up, and she leans in close to me. Wanna hear a real doozy? She asks. She tells me about how, when she first started, there was a case that got a lot of attention in the media. A family had been out berry picking in an area of the forest very close to the entrance of the park. They had two little boys, both under the age of five, and at some point during the day, one of them vanishes. there's an absolutely massive search, and they find absolutely nothing. It's another of those cases where it's like the kid was never there in the first place. The dogs just sit down and don't pick up on anything, no trace of the kid is found. The search goes on for about 2 months, but is eventually called off. Fast forward to 6 months later. The family comes back to place flowers at a memorial that's been set up there for the kid. They bring their other son. While they're placing the flowers, they lose sight of the kid for about 3 seconds, and in that span of time he vanishes into thin air. Now obviously, the parents are beyond devastated. It's awful enough to lose one child, but to lose two is beyond imagining. The search is huge, one of the largest in state history. There are about 300 volunteers combing every inch of this park, looking for the kid. But again, there's no trace of him. The search goes on for about a week, with people looking miles from the part of the park he vanished from. And then, almost 2 weeks later, a volunteer almost 15 miles from the designated search area radios in that he's found the kid. They assumed that the kid was dead, but the volunteer says he's not only alive, he's in good shape. Jackie and her team go out to recover the kid, and when they get there, she can't believe that this is the kid that's been missing. His clothes are clean, there's no dirt on him anywhere, and he doesn't appear traumatized. The volunteer says he found the kid sitting on a log, playing with a little twig bundle that's bound together with some old rope. Jackie asks him where he's been, who he was with for those 2 weeks, and the kid tells her that he's been with the fuzzy man. Now Jackie firmly believes in Bigfoot, so she gets all excited and asks what he means by fuzzy. Was he hairy? But the kid says no, he wasn't hairy. He was a fuzzy man, and he describes a man that's blurry, like when you close your eyes but not all the way closed. He says the man came out of the trees and took the kid with him deep into the woods. The kid says he slept in a hollow tree, and the fuzzy man gave him berries to eat. Jackie asks if the man was mean, if he scared the kid, and the kid says no, he wasn't scary. But I didn't like how he didn't have eyes. Jackie says they get the kid back to headquarters, and a cop takes him into town to talk to him more about what happened. She's friends with the cop that talked to him, and she said the kid described being kept in this tree by the fuzzy man, and given berries whenever he was hungry. He was allowed to wander around a very specific clearing, but when he tried to go further, the fuzzy man would get mad and yell real loud even though he didn't have a mouth. When the kid got scared at night, the fuzzy man made it go brighter and gave him the twig bundle. He said the fuzzy man was going to keep him, but he had to let him go because the kid wasn't the right kind. He either can't or won't elaborate more on that. The cops are just sort of left scratching their heads, and the search for his brother is renewed with no results. The kid has no idea where his brother might be, and they never find him. The last story that Jackie told me was of something that happened to her when she got separated from her training group when she was a rookie. They were learning the basics of high elevation belaying on a well-mapped side of the mountain, and she had to use the bathroom. She went off about 50 yards from the group during a meal break, and did her business. I'll tell the rest exactly as she told it to me, so I go to take a piss, and once I'm done, I start going back to the group. But I've only gotten about 5 feet when I realize that I have no idea where I am. And this wasn't a, oh, I got turned around lost. I mean, I had literally no clue where I was. If you'd asked me, I don't even think I'd have been able to tell you what state we were in. It was sort of how I imagine people with amnesia feel, you know? You're completely lost, and you have no idea what to do. So I stood there for a while, just trying to figure out where I was and what I was supposed to do. But the longer I stand there, the more confused and turned around I get, so I started walking. As I recall, I just picked a random direction and went for it. And as I'm walking, it's just getting worse and worse to the point where I have no concept of why I'm on the mountain in the first place. I'm just trudging through the snow, and then I start hearing this voice. It's kind of inside my head, almost. Like if a frog could talk, all low and croaky. And it's telling me over and over it's okay, you just need to find something to eat. Find something to eat and you'll be okay, just keep walking and find something to eat. 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 So I start looking around for anything that I can eat, and I swear to God I've never felt that hungry in my whole life. It was bottomless, and I think that I had eaten just about anything you put in front of me right then. I had no concept of time, so I had no idea how long I'd been out when I hear an actual voice coming toward me. I go toward it and see one of the other SARs, and he looks terrified. He's running toward me, asking if I'm okay and what the hell I'm doing out here. And the scary thing was, as he's running toward me, I kind of see myself reaching into my belt for my hunting knife. I'm not even really thinking about what I'm doing, but what I am thinking is that I have to eat. If I don't eat, I'll never be okay again, so I just have to eat. He sees me doing that and he backs off right away. He yells at me to put my knife away, that he's not gonna hurt me, and that kind of snaps me back. All of a sudden, I know exactly where I am, and I put the knife away. I run to him and ask him how long I've been gone, thinking he'll tell me I've been gone for half an hour or so. But he tells me I've been gone for 2 days. I've gone over two peaks, ended up almost on the other side of the mountain, and if I'd kept going, I would have ended up wandering into about 300 miles of wilderness. They'd never have found me. He can't believe I'm not dead, and of course I don't know what to think. To me, no time has passed at all. I don't say anything, I just go back with him to a rendezvous point, and I'm taken back to HQ to be airlifted to the hospital. When I get there, they do all kinds of tests, and try to figure out what happened. As best they can guess, I had some kind of weird fugue state, which is kind of like amnesia, or a weird seizure that knocked my brain out of whack. But the truth is that we really don't know. It's never happened again, but I'll tell you, ever since then I never go out there alone. People rag on me for making them come with me when I have to leave the group, but I just tell them that listening to me piss in the snow is better than losing me for 2 days on a freezing mountain. The next person I talked to was EW, a former trainer who now works as an EMT. He still comes to ops like this to help out, but doesn't work full-time for us anymore. He specialized in finding lost kids, he just seemed to have a sixth sense when it came to knowing where they'd gone. He's a legend among the more senior vets, but he gets embarrassed if you compliment him on his work. He sat down with me at dinner one evening, and we ended up swapping stories. Most of them were just casual, but when we got on the subject of our weirder calls, I mentioned that I'd had a buddy who'd gone up a set of stairs. He got kind of quiet and asked me if I'd heard of a little boy who'd disappeared from his park a few years back. I hadn't, so he told me this story. They were out looking for this 11-year-old boy, Joey, who'd gone missing near a river. Of course, the first thought was that he'd fallen in and drowned, but when they brought dogs out, they led SAR officers away from the river and up into a very densely forested area. When we do searches for people, we search in a grid pattern, and we search every box of the grid incredibly thoroughly. What EW's team noticed right away was that a very strange pattern was emerging. Dogs in alternating boxes were picking up Joey's scent, but losing it when they overlapped with another box. If you think of a checkerboard, Joey's scent was being picked up in random black squares, but never in red. This, of course, didn't make any sense, because how could the kid bounce from area to area without leaving a scent in each place he passed? EW and his partner pass into a new box of the grid, and EW notices a set of stairs about 50 yards away. He tells his partner that they need to go check near it, but his partner flat out refuses. He tells EW that he's made it a point never to go near any stairs he sees, and that while it may be routine, he's not to pretend that it's normal. He tells EW that he'll wait in sight while EW checks. EW says he was irritated, but he felt for the guy, and didn't push him on the subject. I walked over to the stairs. They were small, kind of like stairs into a basement. I don't really feel strongly one way or the other about them. The stairs, I mean, so I wasn't scared or anything. I guess I'm like everyone else, and I'd just prefer not to think about them too much. Anyway, I went over and I could see that there was something lying on the bottom step, sort of curled up. My hair sinks, because of course you always hope for the best. And we were confident that we'd find this kid alive, because he'd only been missing for a few hours. But I knew right away that it was him, and that he was dead. He was curled up in a little ball on the step, holding his stomach. It looked like he'd been in horrible pain when he died, but I didn't see any blood except some on his lips and chin. I radioed him that I'd found him, and we got his body back to command. That poor family, they were devastated. The parents couldn't understand how he'd be dead, 'cause he'd only been gone for such a short amount of time. And on top of that, we didn't have any obvious cause of death, which just made it worse. I figured he'd probably eaten something poisonous, since he was holding his stomach when I found him, but I didn't want to guess. It's hard enough to hear that your kid is dead, let alone have some stupid SAR guy guessing about what happened. They took him away, and I went home and tried not to think about it. I hate finding dead kids, man. I love this job, but it's one of the reasons I left. I've got two daughters, and the thought of losing them that way just... He choked up a little here. I'm not great with emotional stuff like that, and it's always sort of awkward to see a grown man cry, so I didn't really know what to do. He pulled himself together eventually, though, and he kept going. We don't always hear back from the coroners about cause of death. It's not really our job to know, I guess, and sometimes if they think it's foul play, they won't tell us because of legal bullshit. But I've got a friend who works for the sheriff's department, and he'll usually pass along any interesting info if I ask. In this case, though, I actually got a call from him about a week later. He asks if I remember the kid, and of course I do, and he says some seriously weird shit is going on. He tells me, EW, man, you're gonna think I'm crazy, but the coroner has no idea what happened to this kid. He's never seen anything like it. My friend goes on to tell me that when the coroner opened the kid up, he couldn't even believe what he was seeing. The kid's organs were like Swiss cheese. Quarter-sized holes were punched clean through just about every single organ this kid had, aside from his heart and lungs. But his colon, his stomach, his kidneys and even one of his testicles were full of these clean holes. My friend said the coroner described it as if someone had taken a hole punch and punched holes out of everything. They were so neat. But the kid didn't have a scratch on him, no entry or exit wounds. The closest anyone there had ever seen like it was a guy who'd filled himself full of buckshot a year or so back while cleaning his rifle. No one had a clue what could possibly have caused it. My friend asked me if I'd ever heard of anything like it, or if we'd had similar cases in the past. But I'd never even heard of something like that, and I told him I wasn't going to be of any help to him. As far as I know, the coroner determined the cause of death as something like massive internal bleeding, but no one knows what really happened. I've never been able to forget that kid. I have nightmares about it sometimes. I don't let my kids go into the woods alone, and when we go together, I never let them out of my sight. I used to love it out here. But that case, and a couple others, just sort of ruined it for me. Dinner was over, so we started to clean up and go back to our cabins. Before we went our separate ways, he put his hand on my shoulder and looked at me really close. He tells me that there's bad things out here. Things that don't care if we have families or lives, or that we can think and feel. He tells me to be careful, and he walks away. I didn't have a chance to talk with him again, but that story stuck with me. By pure coincidence, I got to talk to another vet, PB, who's been in the SAR field for years. We were partnered on a grid sweep during a training exercise, and we were chatting casually about how we liked the job, what kinds of things we'd seen, and the like. At one point, we passed an old set of stairs, though these were probably from an old fire lookout, given the area that we were in. I sort of casually mentioned that I was curious about the stairs, and that I wished I knew more about them. He got kind of quiet and looked like he wanted to tell me something, but wasn't sure if he should. Finally, he told me to turn my radio off. Obviously, this is something we are never, ever supposed to do, but I did it, and he did the same. About 7 years ago, he tells me, he was out on a call with a rookie. They were in an area of the park that's had a lot of strange reports and events. Disappearances, stories about lights in the forest, odd noises, things like that. The rookie was totally spooked, kept going on and on about things out in the woods. According to PB, the guy wouldn't stop talking about the Goatman. Just on and on, Goatman this and Goatman that. Finally, I told him that there was plenty else to be afraid of out here that was very real, and that he'd better get over this thing with the goat man. The rookie wanted to know what kinds of things I was talking about, and I just told him to shut up and walk. We crested a little ridge and there was a staircase about 10 yards ahead. The rookie stops dead in his tracks and just stands there looking at them. I tell him, "See? That's something you should be afraid of." The rookie asks me what the hell these are doing out here, and for some reason, I just open up and tell him the truth. Or what I've been told is the truth. I could have gotten in a lot of trouble for doing what I did, and I could get in a lot of trouble for repeating it to you. But you're a nice kid, and I want you to stop looking into this. Quit while you're ahead. So I'll tell you what I know, under the condition that you never breathe a word of this to the Supes. I told him I wouldn't say a word, and he double checks that our radios are off. When I first started out, we were a little less tight-lipped about them and other things that happen out here. We warned people before they were even hired that there was weird shit going on. I guess the Forest Service was tired of having such a massive turnover rate, and they wanted people to know what they were getting into. So they started having people sign these agreements that they wouldn't go to the media about what they were going to see. The FS didn't want to scare people away, so the last thing they needed were spooked rookies running off to the media with stories of ghosts and haunted stairs. But eventually, they found that the agreements weren't necessary. People not only didn't want to talk about what they saw, they wouldn't. A few times, media tried to talk to people when kids or hikers would disappear, and no one would say a word. I can't really explain it. I guess we just don't really want to admit anything is wrong. This is our job, to be out in the woods every single day. We don't need to be spooked, and the best way to avoid that is to pretend like everything's okay. So I'll tell you everything I can think of, and after that, I'm done talking about it for good. And I expect you not to bring it up around me, ever. The stairs have been out here as long as the parks have existed. We have records going back decades describing them. Sometimes people go up them, and nothing happens. Other times. Look, I really don't like talking about this, but sometimes, really bad shit happens. I saw one guy get his hand sliced clean off when he got to the top step. He reached out to touch a tree branch, and it happened so fast. One second his hand was there, and the next it was gone. Completely clean wound. We didn't find his hand, and the guy almost died. Another time, a woman touched one of the stairs, and a blood vessel in her brain exploded. Literally exploded, like a water balloon. She sort of stumbled down and came over to me, and all she got out was, "I think something is wrong with me." She dropped like a sack of flour, dead before she hit the ground. I'll never forget the way the blood leaked into the inside of her eye. Before she died, I watched it turn red. I watched it happen and there wasn't a single thing I could do to help. We warn people not to go anywhere near them, but there's always at least one idiot who does. And even if nothing happens to them, something bad always happens. Kids go missing as we're on their trail. Someone dies the next day, cut in half in a completely safe part of the park. I don't know why, but something bad always happens. I don't know exactly why they're out here, but it doesn't matter. They're here, and if we were smart, we'd tell our new officers exactly what they're capable of. We were both quiet for a little while. I was afraid to talk because I wasn't sure if he was done. He looked like he wanted to say something else. Finally, he spoke up again. "Have you ever noticed how you can't find the same ones twice?" I nodded, expecting him to continue. But he just stayed quiet, walking alongside me, and eventually he started a story about the biggest deer he'd ever seen in the park. I didn't bring up the subject again, and I didn't press him for any more stories. He dropped out of the op the next day. Apparently he left before the sun came up. He said he was sick. None of us have heard from him since he left.